Chapter 16, The Chamber of Secrets. All those times we were in that bathroom and she was just three toilets away, said Ron bitterly at breakfast next day, and we could have asked her, and now it had been hard enough trying to look for spiders, escaping their teachers long enough to sneak into a girl's bathroom. The girl's bathroom, moreover, right next to the scene of the first attack, was going to be almost impossible. But something happened in their first lesson, Transfiguration, that drove the Chamber of Secrets out of their minds for the first time in weeks. 10 minutes into the class, Professor McGonagall told them that their exams would start on the 1st of June, 1 week from today. "Exams," howled Seamus Finnegan. "We are still getting exams." There was a loud bang behind Harry as Neville Longbottom's wand slipped, vanishing one of the legs on his desk. Professor McGonagall restored it with a wave on her own wand and turned, frowning, to Seamus. "The whole point of keeping the school open at this time is for you to receive your education," she said sternly. "The exams will therefore take place as usual, and I trust you are all studying hard." Studying hard? It had never occurred to Harry that there would be exams with the castle in this state. There was a great deal of mutinous muttering around the room, which made Professor McGonagall scowl even more darkly. "Professor Dumbledore's instructions were to keep the school running as normally as possible," she said, "and that, I need hardly point out, means finding out how much you have learned this year." Harry looked down at the pair of white rabbits he was supposed to be turning into slippers. What had he learned so far this year? He couldn't seem to think of anything that would be useful in an exam. Ron looked as though he did just been told he had to go and live in the Forbidden Forest. "Can you imagine me taking exams with this?" he asked Harry, holding up his wand, which had just started whistling loudly. 3 days before their first exam, Professor McGonagall made another announcement at breakfast. "I have good news," she said, and the great hall, instead of falling silent, erupted. "Dumbledore's back, coming back," several people yelled joyfully. "You have caught the heir of Slytherin," squealed a girl at the Ravenclaw table. "Quidditch matches are back on," roared Wood excitedly. When the hubbub had subsided, Professor McGonagall said, "Professor Sprout has informed me that the mandrakes are cutting at last. Tonight we will be able to revive those people who have been petrified. I need hardly remind you all that one of them may be able to tell us who or what attacked them. I am hopeful that this dreadful year will end with our catching the culprit." There was an explosion of cheering. Harry looked over at the Slytherin table and wasn't at all surprised to see that Draco Malfoy hadn't joined in. Ron, however, was looking happier than he did look 10 days. "It won't matter that we never asked Myrtle then," he said to Harry. "Hermione will probably have all the answers when they wake her up. Mind you, she will go crazy when she finds out we have got exams in 3 days' time. She hasn't studied. It might be kinder to leave her where she is till they are over." Just then, Ginny Weasley came over and sat down next to Ron. She looked tense and nervous, and Harry noticed that her hands were twisting in her lap. "What's up?" said Ron, helping himself to more porridge. Ginny didn't say anything, but glanced up and down the Gryffindor table with a scared look on her face that reminded Harry of someone, though he couldn't think who. "Spit it out," said Ron, watching her. Harry suddenly realized who Ginny looked like. She was rocking backward and forward slyly in her chair, exactly like Dobby did when he was teetering on the edge of revealing forbidden information. "I've got to tell you something," Ginny mumbled, carefully not looking at Harry. "What is it?" said Harry. Ginny looked as though she couldn't find the right words. "What?" said Ron. Ginny opened her mouth, but no sound came out. Harry leaned forward and spoke quietly so that only Ginny and Ron could hear him. "Is it something about the Chamber of Secrets? Have you seen something, someone acting oddly?" Ginny drew a deep breath, and at that precise moment, Percy Weasley appeared, looking tired and worn. If you have finished eating, I will take that seat. Ginny, I'm starving. I've only just come off patrol duty." Ginny jumped up as though her chair had just been electrified, gave Percy a fleeting, frightened look, and scampered away. Percy sat down and grabbed a mug from the center of the table. "Percy," said Ron angrily, She was just about to tell us something important. Halfway through a gulp of tea, Percy choked. "What sort of thing?" he said, coughing. I just asked her if she did seen anything odd, and she started to say, "Oh, Dad, that's nothing to do with Chamber of Secrets," said Percy at once. "How do you know?" said Ron, his eyebrows raised. "Well, if you must know, Ginny walked in on me the other day when I was, well, never mind. The point is, she spotted me doing something, and I asked her not to mention it to anybody. I must say, I did think she did keep her word. It's nothing really, I did just rather." Harry had never seen Percy look so uncomfortable. "What were you doing, Percy?" said Ron, grinning. "Go on, tell us, we won't laugh." Percy didn't smile back. "Pass me those rolls, Harry, I am starving." Harry knew the whole mystery might be solved tomorrow without their help, but he wasn't about to pass up a chance to speak to Myrtle if it turned up, and to his delight it did mid-morning when they were being led to History of Magic by Gilderoy Lockhart. Lockhart, who had so often assured them all danger had passed only to be proved wrong right away, was now wholeheartedly convinced that it was hardly worth the trouble to see them safely down the corridors. His hair wasn't as sleek as usual. It seemed he had been up most of the night patrolling the fourth floor. "Mark my words," he said, ushering them around a corner. "The first words out of those poor petrified people's mouths will be, 'It was Hagrid.' Frankly, I am astounded, Professor McGonagall thinks all these security measures are necessary." "I agree, sir," said Harry, making Ron drop his books in surprise. "Thank you, Harry," said Lockhart graciously while they awaited for a long line of Hufflepuffs to pass. "I mean, we teachers have quite enough to be getting on with without walking students to classes and standing guard all night." "That's right," said Ron, catching on. "Why don't you leave us here, sir? We have only got one more corridor to go." "You know, Weasley, I think I will," said Lockhart. "I really should go and prepare my next class." And he hurried off. "Prepare his class?" Ron sneered after him, gone to curl his hair more like. Then they let the rest of the Gryffindors draw ahead of them, then darted down a side passage and hurried off towards Moaning Martyr's bathroom. But just as they were congratulating each other on their brilliant scream, "Potter, Weasley, what are you doing?" It was Professor McGonagall, and her mouth was the thinnest of thin lines. We were, Ron stammered. "We were going to go and see Hermione," said Harry. Ron and Professor McGonagall both looked at him. "We haven't seen her for ages, Professor," Harry went on, hurriedly treading on Ron's foot. "And we thought we did sneak into the hospital wing, you know, and tell her the mandrakes are nearly ready and not to worry." Professor McGonagall was still staring at him, and for a moment Harry thought she was going to explode, but when she spoke, it was in a strangely croaky voice. "Of course," she said, and Harry, amazed, saw a tear glistening in her beady eye. "Of course, I realize this has all been hardest on the friends of those who have been. I quite understand." "Yes, Potter, of course you may visit Miss Granger. I will inform Professor Binns where you have gone. Tell Madame Pomfrey I have given my permission." Harry and Ron walked away, hardly daring to believe that they did avoid detention. As they turned the corner, they distinctly heard Professor McGonagall blow her nose. "That," said Ron fervently, "was the best story you have ever come up with. They had no choice now but to go to the hospital wing and tell Madame Pomfrey that they had Professor McGonagall's permission to visit Hermione. Madame Pomfrey let them in, but reluctantly. "There is just no point talking to a petrified person," she said, and they had to admit she had a point when they did take in their seats next to Hermione. It was plain that Hermione didn't have the faintest inkling that she had visitors, and they might just as well tell her bedside cabinet not to worry, for all the good it would do. "Wonder if she did see the attacker, though," said Ron, looking sadly at Hermione's rigid face, "because if he sneaked up on them all, no one will ever know." But Harry wasn't looking at Hermione's face. He was more interested in her right hand. It lay clenched on top of her blankets, and bending closer, he saw that a piece of paper was crunched inside her fist. Making sure that Madame Pomfrey was nowhere near, he pointed this out to Ron. "Try and get it out," Ron whispered, shifting his chair so that he blocked Harry from Madame Pomfrey's view. It was no easy task. Hermione's hand was clamped so tightly around the paper that Harry was sure he was going to tear it. While Ron kept watch, he tugged and twisted, and at last, after several tense minutes, the paper came free.